My name is Umang Kumar. On behalf of the South Asia Center, I want to welcome you all to the first Omar Khalidi Memorial Human Rights Panel, which is titled Rapes of Dalit Women in Haryana, India, Caste, Class, and Sexual Violence. This panel is in memory of Dr. Omar Khalidi, a human rights activist in the Boston area, and he was associated with MIT for several years. Dr. Khalidi passed away on November 29, 2010. So his second anniversary was a couple of days ago. And all of us still remember him as a firm supporter of the South Asia Center and a champion of the rights of the disenfranchised, the discriminated, and the disadvantaged. His two books, Khaki and Ethnic Violence in India, Army, Police, and Paramilitary Forces During Communal Riots, 2003, and Muslims in Indian Economy, 2006, had focused on the institutional discrimination against Muslims in India, and they created quite a furore in the Indian Parliament. So it is, in a way, to honor him that we said, you know, let's start this series also, and we hope to have many more events in this kind of a series. So this is the first. I should have started with certain apologies. We said we'll start at 7, but when all of us arrived, some of us arrived here ahead of time, we found that this room was, somebody was squatting in this room, and they told us that they have the room till 7:30, whereas they had it only till 6:30. So we finally showed them proof, and they graciously left. we'll be starting about half an hour after our scheduled time, which is terribly surprising for many of us. So we have an exciting evening ahead of us, and to introduce the panelists and begin the proceedings, I will first introduce our moderator for the evening, Priyanka Borpujari, who will take the discussion forward. Before I do that, we have passed around some leaflets about an upcoming event on Venezuela, and recent elections in Venezuela. And we will also be passing a mailing list for the South Asia Center around. So when you see that coming around, you can choose to put your name, email, contact address. So Priyanka Borpujari, who is our moderator for the evening, is currently the International Women's Media Foundation's Elizabeth Neufert Fellow for 2012-2013 at the Center for International Development at MIT. She has been a fearless journalist covering various issues of oppression of the marginalized communities, especially the indigenous communities in various parts of India, certainly in central India. You can follow her blog by going to, and that's the only one, priyanka-borpujari.blogspot.com. We'll write it up later here, so I think it's very insightful. So with this, I'll hand it over to Priyanka, who will introduce the panelists and conduct the proceedings for the evening.
Thank you, Umang. Once again, welcome everyone to Dr. Omar Khalidi Memorial Panel on Rapes of Dalit Women in Haryana, Caste, Class, and Sexual Violence in India. The first panel starting Indian Standard Time, but that's okay. But before I proceed, I would just request a small exercise. Let's remove our cell phones. And you know, click the silent button or switch it off. Thank you. So what we are going to have this evening is that our panelists are going to have a maximum of 15 minutes to speak. And after their presentations, we will have a Q&A session. Let's just begin. I'll begin with the introductions. First, we have Kritika Chandrasekhar, who's sitting in the middle. She is a banking professional with expertise in asset liability management and liquidity management. She's been keenly involved with volunteer organizations like Akanksha and Anikali in India, which embrace the cause of youth education and empowerment. Currently, she's pursuing international relations at the Harvard School of Continuing Education as a means to foray deeper into the field of women and youth development. On to Kritika's left. Is that left? Left is Rama Srinivasan. She is a PhD student at the Anthropology Department at Brown University, Providence. She studies issues of love and intimacy and questions of legitimacy that surround these ideas in the context of Haryana. And she also has interest in gender and feminist studies, sexuality studies, and film theory. And here's Padma Balasubramaniam on my left. She's a physician at the Brigham and Women's Division of Endocrinology and Diabetes. She worked with the women's organization in Hyderabad in India, fighting against dowry and harassment of women as a student. She also supports women's organizations in India that are fighting for justice and equality. So let's get our evening finally started with Kritika, your presentation.
Thank you, Priyanka, for the introduction. Before I begin introducing this panel discussion on caste, class, and sexual violence in India, let me say a few words that can enable our complacent selves to give a complacent pat on our backs. So India has now transitioned from a developing nation or a third world nation and is now a world player in the world economy. It has opened up its sectors to foreign direct investment. Post 2008, after the credit crisis, it has become one of the most attractive hubs for foreign portfolio investment. It has consistently managed a real GDP growth rate of 5.5% to as high as 10.4% between 1999 to 2011. In a country that has 6 lakhs plus villages, internet and mobile phones have reached villages where even the supply of water hasn't reached. As an outsourcing hub for the accomplished West, it provides job opportunities to lakhs and lakhs of people. Gurgaon, which is near the national capital of Delhi, boasts of a per capita income that is highest among the G20 countries. However, you need to contrast this with the fact that India has one of the most skewed sex ratios in the world, 933 females to 1,000 males. India accounts for 22% of the world's maternal deaths, the number being as high as 171,000. For the same level of education and for the same type of work done by both men and women, India has the largest disparities in gender-based wage income. And coming to our topic, in this small but densely populated state of Haryana, within September to October 2012, there were as many as 19 rape cases that were reported. Yes, so on the 9th of September 2012, a 16-year-old, I hope everybody is able to see the map. On 9th of September 2012, a 16-year-old Dalit girl in the village of Davya was raped by 8 young men. There were 4 other men who were filming the horrific incident. When she finally mustered up the courage to approach her father, the perpetrators of the rape threatened her that they would go public with the MMS. Her father had no option but he chose suicide. Barely 3 weeks later in the village of Banwasa, which lies in the Sonmat district, a young married woman was abducted by 4 men from her house, forced into a car, thrown into a shed where she was raped consecutively for 5 days. In the village of Pilukhera, which is in the Jind district in Haryana, a 30-year-old married woman was being raped by 3 men and they were also filming the crime. It was only on the repeated cries of her daughter, who actually was looking at the incident through the window, did the rapist actually leave. Coming to Fatehpur, a 13-year-old girl was being raped by a fruit vendor for over a period of 4 months. When she did decide to come clear in front of her family decided to press charges. Now, I think justice in Haryana has a different way of being delivered, because the fruit vendor has not been convicted, but the rape victim and 2 of her sisters have been expelled from school. The self-immolation of a 16-year-old rape victim, again in Jind, brought down the Prime Minister Sonia Gandhi to Haryana, and she condemned the state of affairs that was taking place in Haryana. But in spite of her visit, the incident of rape continues unabated. Now, there are varying responses from the different officials in power that have been given regarding these incidents. So the Chief Minister of West Bengal, Ms. the Honorable Mamata Banerjee, maintains that the incidence of rape is a direct consequence of increased intermingling between men and women. Subhe Singh, who is a prominent village council member, maintains that the marriageable age of young women should be brought down from 18 years to 16 years so that they have their husbands to satisfy their sexual desires. The ex-chief minister of Haryana, Mr. Om Prakash Chautala, seconds this opinion, and he sees no difference between 21st century modern India and 17th century medieval India, where you married women at a very young age to prevent red-blooded Mughals from taking advantage of them. The most interesting observation has been offered by one Mr. Jitendra Chattar, who is again a member of the Khap Panchayat of the village council. He maintains that rape has increased because of the increased consumption of spicy food like chowmein. I think this is like the most practical observation and the most practical solution. So we stop consuming chowmein, we stop consuming spicy food, we start eating Kellogg's cornflakes, barley and oats, and women would no longer be raped in India. But at this point, it becomes pertinent to ask the question, why rape? And why rape in Haryana? As far as the statistic goes, Mizoram with reported cases of 7.1 of every 100,000 people is the worst state in India for rape. And Haryana reports 2.9 rape cases per 100,000 people. So, and it doesn't even feature in the top 5. So why talk about rapes in Haryana at all? But we must note that Nagaland is a largely tribal state, and their caste inequalities in Nagaland are not that prominent. Moreover, the predominant tribe in Nagaland, the Khasi tribe, has very strong matrilineal leanings. Haryana, with its significant population of high caste Jats and low caste Chamars, presents a highly patriarchal society in which caste hierarchies are very firmly etched. One can trace a very systematic pattern in all these rapes. It is no mere coincidence that a dozen of the 19 reported rape cases have been related to Dalit women, low caste women. Over the years, rape from being a crime of passion has gradually and alarmingly translated into a weapon of domination of one class over the other class. In Haryana itself, the number of rape cases that were reported in 2011 were as high as 733. You can even see with the help of these two graphs that the incidence of rape has gone over. 1994 is towards the right and 2008 being the left. It has exponentially increased. Now a very easy argument would be to say that, you know, maybe it is not the incidence of rape that has increased, maybe the incidence of reporting rape has increased. So we can't really assume much from this statistic. Maybe it could be. But why rape? Because rape breaks not only a woman, it breaks her relationships, it breaks her family, it can break an entire community. Now, it sends the message as, who is the boss? In a patriarchal society, the chastity and purity of a woman is considered to be the supreme. And when this chastity is debauched by a person who's not her partner, the self-dignity of a woman falls down to an extent where she is not even considered to be better than a mild object. But, so, this sort of mindset made sense like centuries and centuries ago when one tribe was invading the territory of another tribe. So putting the sexual chastity of your women on a pedestal made sense because you obviously did not want your women to be taken over by the other tribe and then establish a line of progeny with them. But this mindset has been so firmly etched in succeeding generations that more often than not, a woman who is a victim of a rape thinks that the rape is on account of her own undoing. Talking a little bit more about the socio-cultural dynamics of the state, it becomes interesting to note, not interesting, it actually, it's shocking to note that the state has the worst sex ratio in the country. Let me show you. Can you see this?
Yes.
Yeah.
So it was 835 in 1911, it has gone to 877 females for every 1,000 males, which is still abysmally low. But look at India, I mean, we were better off in 1901 when it was 972 females, and now in 2001 we are 933 females to 1,000 males. And I can't explain the statistics. I mean, with the economic development and development in Medicare and healthcare, what do we say? Were we just waiting for the British to leave so that we could start killing our girl babies? I don't know. So to this lopsided patriarchal society, you add the fact that caste hierarchies are firmly etched in stone. In the Indian context, at least, it is your caste that defines your economic status and not the other way around. Low caste, more often than not, are economically disadvantaged, with little or no tangible property that they can use as a means of production. The predominant population in Haryana is that of the land-owning Jat caste. Politics at the local level is under the patronage of the Khap Panchayats that are composed totally of self-elected male Jats. Intermingling outside the caste is strictly prohibited. Marriage outside the caste is unthinkable. And they even frown down on same Gotra marriages, which is of the same familial lineage. So what does this skewed sex ratio of 877 females to 1,000 males do to the testosterone levels of the men in such society? And it's interesting to note that Khap Panchayats do not condone sex with a Dalit woman. You can have sex with her, but you can't marry her. Indeed, and if it's a low-caste woman we are talking about, she would be pre-writing her obituary if she were to refuse sex to a high-caste child. Now let's talk economics. 19 out of... Haryana has 19 districts, 7 districts out of which fall in the national capital region. 41% of Haryana lives in that region. So 38% of Haryana's towns and 38% of Haryana's villages lives in the national capital region. Now this region has seen an unprecedented growth in terms of urbanization, commercialization, industrialization, what have you. So, and the land near or between, say, Panipat, Sonpat, Rohtak, Gurgaon, Fatehpur can cost anywhere between a crore to like 5 crores for 1 acre. Just to give you an example, Karnal, which was like the center of the Green Revolution when it was launched. So 1 acre of land in Karnal, just after the Green Revolution took off, costed about a lakh an acre. Today it easily costs in crores of rupees. So as a result of this, you have a class of agricultural land owning, high caste Jats who have become millionaires overnight. But the flip side of it is that this development or this wealth has not percolated down to the lower caste of the society. And another point is that this economic development is not commensurate with intellectual development. So Haryana ranks number 1 in India in terms of per capita GDP. It ranks number 11 in terms of total GDP. But it ranks 22 out of the 28 states when it concerns literacy. So Haryana's literacy ratio is 77%, and maybe 67% of Haryana's women are educated. Let me now take a quick minute and just mention how the state uses gender and sexuality to curb dissent. By targeting women through torture that is sexual in nature, by branding a woman as a slut and a whore, the state machinery hits her where it hurts, her character and morality. A state that wishes to suppress a democratic movement sees women participants as very easy target. And there is something very grotesque about the sexual defamation of a woman. And the most, the example that comes to mind is that of Soni Sori, details of which can be found in Priyanka's blog. So she is an Adivasi or a tribal teacher and a human rights activist. And she rose to prominence in 2011 when she began voicing issues like human rights violations which were committed both by the police and by the Naxalites. She was arrested on the suspicion of her being a courier agent between the SR company and Naxalites. She wasn't given a fair trial. Within 3 days of her arrest, she was moved to Dantewada jail where she has suffered torture of an unimaginable kind. SP Ankit Garg, who was responsible for her arrest, has called her a loose whore who sleeps around with Naxals to take favors from them. Now, questioning of a woman's virtue has made thousands of other women apprehensive about taking a stand on issues. In a society that looks at women to uphold their honor even in the face of death, such kind of character assassination does not only vilify the immediate victim, it sort of creates an era of fear where people would rather suffer in silence than ever let their voices be known. So this is just to give you an introduction to the topics that we are going to be discussing today in the panel. I'm sure Rama and Padma will do a much better job of it. Thank you. Thanks, Trishika. That definitely was a very very broad and yet a very succinct and informative background on demographics and what makes or breaks Haryana. Let's now move over to Rama, who will give her perspective from her studies and otherwise.
Okay. Firstly, I want to thank Kritika for actually laying out all the statistics so that my job has become much easier. I can just send some of my observations as part of my field work, and I hope it makes sense. I first became interested in Haryana around 2007 when cases of so-called family killings were making it to the mainstream news channels in a big way. And I was at least as interested in the news as I was in the way it was being represented. So these news reports isolated and probably even stigmatized Haryana in a very decisive way without actually ever including any analysis of Haryana's specificity. Over the period of time when my interest in Haryana grew, there was a steady increase in an interest in Haryana in mainstream India as well, but caste actually became the euphemisms, as Kritika explained, which is village-based, self-elected caste councils. So they became a euphemism for everything that was wrong out there. And a concrete study of the region, like the one that only Prem Chaudhary probably has conducted, has been consistently ignored. Prem Chaudhary herself was forced to articulate her views on caste, and her reluctance to do so has been consistently ignored. And there are concrete reasons for trying to play down the importance of caste that I can talk to in the discussion section maybe. But yeah, there are concrete reasons for trying to play down the importance of caste that have manifested itself very clearly in the issue we are discussing today, because the news media is now grappling with the crisis of representing something about a state that it now solely identifies by a monster probably of its own creation in many ways, and a monster that it cannot really pin down the blame of the rapes to these bodies, and it's probably deeply frustrating to them. So, since 2005, I think, when it first started covering news, Haryana, to 2012, when the news media has, I think, not learned anything about the specificity about Haryana, nor has it any conception of how to cover rapes, specifically rapes of Dalit women. Even as I come here to present my own views, I have to admit and probably apologize for not having a concrete answer myself. But what I can present is my understanding of Haryana and possible frameworks for discussing this issue. So beyond the figures that we can pull up, Haryana, thanks for doing that, and sex ratios, crimes against women, etc. I think which shed important light on the realities of being a Haryanvi woman, what is really salient about Haryana for me is like this observation by Bhupinder Yadav that though this region was part of Punjab at one point, it has not seen any social reform movement. And this has been critical to my understanding of the state. And I think that Haryana at this moment is undergoing deep social churning with large scale land acquisitions that Kritika was talking about the valuation of mounts and on the one hand, and the high occurrence of elopements, which is my research interest. And these elopements are primarily between people of different castes. And though media focuses on cops and cops on Gotra marriages, it has gone slightly unnoticed that there has probably been only one same Gotra marriage on record. I mean, the Manoj Gavri case, which was like a gruesome honor killing. I'll talk about this marriage later, I think. So most of the couples that I met during my summer fieldwork in Chandigarh said that they were from different castes, or from the same caste, but different Gotras and villages. So what was really interesting for me was that most of them planned to go back to their villages, and the dynamics that they would introduce in the village setting is like a fascinating idea that I intend to study in future. So anyway, for now I can say with reasonable conviction that many of these marriages are between high caste Jat women and low caste Dalit men, and hence it is tempting to consider, and it has been considered as such, as a concern for marriages that reflect social hierarchies, which is true, definitely. But when I interviewed these women and men of the same caste, they told me that the only explanation that the girl's family would give for opposing the match was that they wouldn't do it. I don't know why, but they wouldn't do it according to the choice of the women. So I think the idea that a woman could exercise choice, and I think more specifically to extend sexual consent, is probably at least as problematic as inter-caste marriages themselves. So dominance of certain castes has always existed on the foundations of patriarchy, and the Jat supremacy in Haryana is no different. It rests on patriarchy and their almost near complete control over land. And the two, patriarchy and land control, are themselves very deeply intertwined. So while they are getting huge sums of money for their land, but the fact is also that today the control over both women and land is fast slipping from the hands of Haryana's Jat community, and that has put this community in deep crisis. And one way of reasserting the control over women, over the women's body, has of course been the so-called honor killings. But in 2010, the 2010 verdict of death sentence to 7 of Manoj and Babri's killers, which was later commuted to life imprisonment by the High Court, and almost simultaneous conviction of another very high profile case with killers, which was like, I think, May 2010, has, I think, deeply rattled this moral police. Family members with or without enormous social pressure pressure of social exclusion are increasingly accepting, probably grudgingly, but increasingly accepting such matches, as I had witnessed in my brief summer research. And of course, I need to do much more extensive research to actually prove that these marriages are at least grudgingly being accepted. But rapes of Dalit, I think, have to be seen in this light of Jat masculinity that is increasingly feeling insignificant and even ridiculous. So, but sexual attacks have always been used in service of like displays of power over an entire people. I mean, race politics, colonization, as well as caste oppression in India testifies to this. What is particular about Haryana at this moment is that it is not only an assault on lower castes in the face of an increasing irrelevance, but also a decisive message against the idea of women's right to sexual consent. So I'll end with that.
Thanks, Roman, for some very nice detailing about the interview about between the castes and what the dynamics are in the area. Let's finally move on to Padma.
Thanks a lot. Every time I'm asked to speak on a panel, it seems that I'm the third speaker. And just between us, it's not very often that I get asked to speak on a panel. So I figured having some PowerPoint presentation for people, just in case they're getting really bored and that they don't want to listen to me, you can actually look at some slides. So the two excellent speakers have already spoken about the actual horrific events that took place and also touched upon patriarchy in Haryana. So what I'm going to do is to bring in a few broader issues and try to interconnect the atrocities that took place in Haryana with many such atrocities that took place in 2012 affecting Dalits. And one of the other things that I'm always interested in is what is the role of the state in all this? Is our state, the Indian state, just a benign sort of observer, a mute observer, or does it actually participate in all these horrible things that we hear day in and day out? We can talk a lot about that in our discussion, but let me just go over some of the things that I thought would be important in this. So the first slide is a protest in Haryana by 19 organizations, women's organizations. And as you can see, the police are really welcoming them with those lovely looking sticks, what we call lathis. So just to quote Dr. Ambedkar, turn in any direction you like. Caste is the monster that crosses your path. You cannot have political reform, you cannot have economic reform unless you kill this monster. I read this for the first time many years ago, and this has stayed with me for a long, long time. This is from the National Crimes Record Bureau. There are more statistics that came out in 2011, but I thought this was a nice table. What's interesting is when we were looking at this, if you look at the total number of murder cases, there were only 546 from 1991 to 2000. This is the annual incidents, so every year. And 2001 to 2008, about 672, and if you look at rape, 1261 in 2001 to 2008, 1991 to 2000, it's 929. And I mean, it seems like a really small number, and I think one of the reasons is that these crimes are not often registered because people just don't have the guts to go and say, you know, this person raped me, you know. And even if they're registered, the investigation that follows the registration is extremely shoddy. And from the registration, when it goes to the court, the judges are presented with extremely shoddy evidence. Again, people can disagree with me, but most of our judges, you know on whose side they are. I mean, if you look at some of the judgments in the last 10 years on anything that concerns the people of India, you can pretty much figure out whose interests they represent. So this is the crimes that's reported on an annual basis, and the SCST Prevention of Atrocities Act came into being in 1989, and that is to protect the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe people from atrocities that are particularly related to caste. And again, you know, most of the time this is not taken seriously, and it's not registered under SC and ST Act, even when there has been human rights violation based on caste. So I just want to take the audience back to the Kailanji rapes and murders, which took place in 2006 in September. So this was 6 years ago in September, when one of the most horrific crimes was committed on a family in the Bhandara district in Maharashtra. This was a village called Kailanji. Bhandara district in Maharashtra is called the rice bowl because it's just a very fertile land with a lot of irrigation. So this family of five, the husband, wife, and three children, had actually bought 4 acres of land, and they were cultivating land. When the land was uncultivated, the dominant community could use it as a passage to get to the irrigation facilities. So once they started cultivating the land, they couldn't do that. So from 1989 to 2006, this family was harassed nonstop. So what did our administration do? Pretty much nothing, because the dominant community had MLAs and ministers and local revenue officials, local police officers supporting them. And this is what I mean when I say that, is the state just a mute observer, or is it actively participating in these atrocities? So Surekha is described in many magazines and press, not the mainstream press, again, excuse the pun, M-A-L-E stream press, but the other press, as an Ambedkarite woman who was very socially conscious, very proud, wanted her children to get educated, and her daughter Surekha was doing extremely well in school. So in any case, I won't go through the details. It's everywhere. You just have to Google Kailanji and you'll get the entire Wikipedia on Kailanji. To cut a long story short, Surekha and Priyanka were witnesses to a horrific beating that took place of a Dalit man who happened to be their cousin. And and they actually went to the police station and identified the assailants. And this was in September. 2 weeks later, on September 29th, a mob attacked them, paraded them naked, raped and killed Surekha and Priyanka, and mutilated and killed the two sons. So the only person who escaped was the father. So the police station was 8 kilometers from Kailanji. The police was called. Surekha called them on her mobile phone. Interestingly, her SIM card went missing after that. And the postmortem was conducted in a very shoddy manner, so they said there was no rape that took place. In October, hundreds of thousands of Dalits had gathered in Nagpur to celebrate Ambedkar's conversion to Buddhism. So the state government basically sent a message to the press saying, please do not talk about Kailanji rapes. And who was it, the state government? Who was there heading the state government at the time? It was the Congress. So to cut a long story short again, women, and that's my next slide, Dalit women decided enough was enough, and they just spontaneously came out onto the streets. Thousands of people, and this started actually 4 weeks after the brutal murder, rape and murder. All over Maharashtra in 2006, there were huge protests. Other organizations joined, a lot of women from other organizations and other castes joined, and you will not believe the repression that was let loose on them. There was police firing in Amaravati, people were killed. At the same time, organizations like outfits like Shiv Sena and Bajrang Dal were allowed to take processions to counter these processions, and that was obviously supported by the Congress government, as it always does. So the People's Union of Democratic Rights, People's Union of Civil Liberties, again, there are huge reports about the kind of repression, the number of people who were put in prison. So again, I just want to point out how the state does nothing to prevent these attacks. And the state, after that, criminalizes dissent and criminalizes the protests. So moving on, the Bhatani Tola, this took place in 1996, so you might wonder why I'm bringing it up now. But 21 Dalits, mostly women and children, were massacred by a private militia of landlords called Ranveer Sena. Now, 1996, Lalu Prasad was elected on the plank of social justice. Prior to that, it was a Congress government which had multiple Senas to protect the interests of the agricultural owners. So again, my point is, it may sound simplistic, but it doesn't matter who's in power. It was Congress, and then it was Lalu Yadav. But all these Senas were encouraged by all the governments. So in any case, 2010, after 14 years, 23 were convicted, 3 were given death penalty, and 20 were given life sentence for the horrific crimes in the Sessions Court. Now, why were these Dalits killed? They were killed because they were supporting militant land movements, and it was across caste, across religion. In fact, the communal forces of the state wanted to divide people along religious lines, but no, the people of Hindu faith and people of Muslim faith fought together, and that is not good for the government. So, in any case, 2012, now this year, the Patna High Court actually acquits all of them. So why did they acquit them? Because they said the witnesses who actually saw this could not have really seen this, because had they been there and if it really happened, they would have been murdered as well. So how can we trust the witnesses? So this was one of the things that the judges said. So just interestingly, just before the massacre of the Dalits, Rameshwar Prasad was elected in 1989 as one of the first MPs from Bihar, who was a militant Dalit leader. And in 1995, a year before this massacre, Ram Naresh Ram and Rameshwar Prasad were elected as MLAs from that area. And they were actively involved in militant land struggles. So this is atrocities against Dalits in Dharmapuri, Tamil Nadu. Now, Tamil Nadu, as many of you know, has had some awesome struggles to fight orthodoxy and the Brahminical system from Periyar onwards, who started a self-respect movement. But Tamil Nadu, unfortunately, as we speak now, has one of the highest incidences of atrocities against Dalits. So what happened to all that movement where all the blame was put on the Brahminical order? Now, the Dalits in Dharmapuri, Tamil Nadu, what was the problem? The problem was a Dalit woman married a backward caste woman married a Dalit person, and this was considered a no-no because it was against the rules. So they ended up setting fire to three hamlets in Tamil Nadu, and 500 Dalit houses were destroyed. And this happened in November of this year, about a month before our panel discussion here. And one of the ruling parties, PMK, which has been part of the United Progressive Alliance until recently, their leadership has gone on record saying that we are against inter-caste marriages. And the PMK has been extremely powerful in this area. They burnt these houses with 150 petrol bombs, how could they have gotten the petrol bombs without the police knowing about it? And the police said they were outnumbered. They don't seem to be outnumbered when the women in Hisar come out on the streets to protest the atrocities against the women who were raped, and they said they were outnumbered in Dharmapuri. Now, Lakshmipet, Andhra Pradesh, where I come from, June of 2012, 5 Dalits were killed, again, several injured. The president of the state Congress committee is from that area and is from the dominant community. Again, it was a land that was the underlying conflict. This was a resettled village. Previously, it was evacuated for this Madhubalasar reservoir, and several acres of land were submerged. Again, there are a lot of people here who are doing a lot of work with Indians on rehabilitation, on displacement. I mean, this is the saga of modern India, which the previous speakers have pointed out. I mean, people get, people are asked to leave, and then they come back, and all these land conflicts start. But of course, in this particular case, it appears that the dominant community got a lot of money, but the Dalits did not get money when they were displaced. So I think in the discussion we can talk about this intersection of caste and class. But the interesting things here is that the local MLA also is in the state cabinet, and he's a Dalit. There were a lot of other, the SP, the deputy superintendent of police, the superintendent of police, the Mandal revenue officer, they all happened to be Dalits. So one of the questions that was raised was, there were all these Dalit figures, and how come they could not save the Dalits? It's not as simple as we have seen in many atrocities. Just having a few Dalit figureheads in the bureaucracy doesn't really change the system. So I know I don't have too much time. So we can again bring this up in the discussion. But I want to very quickly address the structural violence in India before I stop. This is, again, something that's very close to my heart. 77% of Indians, according to a study, or 836 million people in India live on a per capita consumption of ₹20 a day. So if you're talking about the Dalit population, which is about 16.5%, and the Adivasi population, which is about 8.4%, and the Muslim population, which is about 14 or 15%, and if you even think that 90% of them, or 99% of them, are extremely poor and are living in terrible conditions, that leaves another 45 to 50% of Indians who are living in equally miserable conditions. And I can tell you, even if you had 100 rupees a day, you probably won't get that far in India. So when we talk about structural violence in India, it's like close to 900 or 950 million people who are in this condition. So my point is that while we have to work towards caste annihilation and fight patriarchy, the important thing also is to remember that the people who have the money, the Indian billionaires, now have $340 billion, which is estimated by the US magazine Forbes, which is 31% of the country's GDP. This gives our Indian ruling class three times more weight in the economy than their American counterparts. So who does it benefit to continue to have this exploitative system where a person is pitted against another person? Men are pitted against women. Castes are pitted against other castes. And poor Dalits and poor Adivasis bear the brunt of everybody. So I'd like to discuss this in the discussion. So what do all these atrocities have in common? The ruling establishment, police, judiciary, whose interests do they represent? Who do they protect when a crime is committed? This is a question that I want to ask. And how does the state with its police respond to protests against violence and injustice? Can we also connect the atrocities against Dalits to atrocities against our Adivasis in Chhattisgarh, Orissa, and to the genocides of Sikhs in 1984 and Muslims in 2002? So, I just want to say that there are any number of examples I can give about the fantastic unity that we have seen recently across class and religion, and some of them are what I've listed. Thank you very much.
I allowed Padma to spill over because Rama had 5 minutes left. But I've just been, I'm sure everyone has a lot of questions, but I've just been taking some notes also. And I think just basically echoing some of the questions that you might have. So these are kind of comments that I have for all three of you. But I think your second last slide had those questions. Perhaps we could just keep that slide on so that we know that, you know, we are that those are the main questions that are in our mind. But other than that, I've also been thinking about, in terms of Haryana, what is the idea of justice? The one before that. Yeah, that and the next one actually is fine. The idea of justice, who really delivers justice? And you know, under whom does one go to for justice and for redressal in such a situation? Secondly, the whole new idea of class element within the caste. In Haryana, you have the upper caste Jats and the lower caste Chamars. It is also definitely possible that the Chamars, some at least a very tiny section, might have economically become affluent. What does that do to the caste dynamic? And if it really does, are they using this newfound, you know, status to forward, you know, and to be the voice of the other Chamars who are still relegated in society? Again, from the Andhra Pradesh perspective, the fact that you have a local MLA and the cops who are from the lower castes, who are Dalits themselves, but again, how strong is the class element then that has come into that they have suddenly forgotten that had it not been for their newfound affluence, that they also could have been oppressed. Now, if we're thinking about that, could we possibly, as a solution, have a different form of pedagogy which is about caste identity politics? I'm just like, this is a very tricky question, I'm wondering, because just like you have it with indigenous communities, where our indigenous identity is our identity and that's what we need to learn, should we possibly have that for the lower castes also? Will that really help them with their identity and possibly counter, or that's going to be bad because that's going to further continue to alienate themselves? So these are just some points that I'm also thinking about. The other thing is about Gurgaon. I mean, how does as a journalist, for me, I'm constantly thinking about how is the media representation? Because Gurgaon, which, as Pratika said, is in the national capital region, is a very globalized, industrialized. It's pretty much like New York, to just give it to people here for them to understand. But Gurgaon has forever had these high number of rapes of women, working women, and it's not even like in the villages that you mostly hear. These are women like us who are just getting back home from work and they have just been raped. And I think at one point there was a police commissioner who said that if you want to avoid getting raped, get home early at by 8 o'clock. So what does that leave? And also, if we are talking about a new era and time in the 21st century, why have these incidences increased? What is the role of media in this, in possibly leading up to a kind of pushing forward in such incidences to take place? Because on one hand, you have literacy going up by a very decimal percentage, but at the same time, you also have access to other means of communication. But does literacy really mean an opening of mind vis-a-vis talking about? And also finally, my last thinking point was about the idea of religious fanaticism that is fueling these Dalit atrocities. Has that also been a possibility? So these are just some of the thoughts that I had. I'm sure you will also have a lot of questions. Maybe we can just open the floor. I know I took a long time, but I'll just be a hypocrite here by saying that please make your questions so short and sweet. We'll have time until about 10 minutes before 9 to have this discussion. Any questions, comments?
My question is to Rama. If you could, clarify. I couldn't really understand that the framework that you're presenting. Was it to understand the increase in the incidence of rape, or was it to generally understand why the rate of rape is high in Haryana?
I am not actually commenting on whether it's high now or not. I mean, Pritika has actually talked about whether it's an increase in the number of rapes or whether it is just increase in the number of reporting. So my framework basically is about talking about, I mean, it's trying to understand rapes of Dalit women at this particular moment in Haryana, and actually talking about what is going on in Haryana at this very moment. And the reason I started with media was that actually to point out its tenuous relationship with Haryana, where Kritika actually rightly pointed out that Haryana is not the place where the highest number of rapes are happening. And why Haryana is important, as I said, was about because the Haryana is being isolated and probably even stigmatized for being this medieval region right outside the capital of the country. And I'm not trying to justify what is happening in Haryana, but I'm just trying to put it into perspective, because for me, the number of rapes, for me, it is just, I want to understand why the rapes are happening at this moment, rather than exploring the question of whether there have been more rapes or less rapes, because I think it is important to understand the pathologies behind the rapes that are happening at this moment, rather than understanding, what was there before or when then right now. So, yeah, that's me.
Okay, if there are no other questions, or if you are trying to frame questions, I have a question or a comment for Padma. Is that, definitely much of your presentation was very thorough in terms of the chronology of events and the way things have been presented. I would just like to know, what do you think personally about the way media is talking about, atrocities against Dalits? That's one question versus the treatment of media just on rape, because it often is a very, in the newsrooms, being a journalist myself, I know rape is a very sexy thing to write about. And I'm sorry to use that word, but that's how it is, because you just run and you have to chase and go about it. And so also, has the media then, do you think, has stayed away from reporting about what's happening in Gurgaon? Because to me, Gurgaon is very fascinating, because it's about this whole intersection of caste and also class at the same time, It's not to say that, I'm not trying to say that in Gurgaon rapes of Dalit women are not taking place, and we should be ignoring that. But just, because we're talking about Haryana specifically as number one important GDP, as you had said. So, and this is for all three of you, I mean, the role of media and what can possibly be, what kind of different narratives we require.
Well, that's a great question, and that's why I just made this silly joke about most of the press being mainstream rather than mainstream. which was actually, I think, coined by an Australian feminist called Sheila Kerr. So, I mean, you are the expert, I mean, you're a journalist. Just going, using Kerlanji as an example, I was just looking at how the press behaved after the murders. For one thing, they were very complicit with the state government. When the state government said, this is not the right time to talk about the Kerlanji rapes and the murders because there is an event that is taking place, and Mayawati is going to be speaking on October 15th, and we really don't want to mess it all up with what is going on, because obviously they were concerned that there would be a lot of protests at the grassroots level, and they're really scared of the grassroots. You know, they're scared of the Dalit women who took to the streets, you know, these awesome women who just challenged the police, challenged the judiciary. So I think, as far as that particular rape was concerned, I think there was very, very biased reporting. Initially, it was all about Kerlanji rape was not really a rape, but it was a love affair that went sour because Surekha, this woman who was a very strong mother and wife and agricultural worker, who had a very good relationship with her first cousin, who was also Dalit, and he was slightly well off, so he could protect them from the dominant community when all these conflicts were going on with the land. So they started focusing only on that it was a love affair that went wrong, and it had nothing to do with the land or nothing to do with the dominant community coming and attacking them as a mob. So I think there clearly it was a very biased reporting until the Dalit organizations and other organizations took it up and said, no, this was not an affair. This was a crime of, you know, one of the most horrific crimes since we got our independence on a family. With regard to the Haryana rapes recently, I mean, from my little knowledge of how the press has treated it, I think there has been some very responsible reporting from some sections. Again, I don't have a bird's eye view of what everybody's saying, but I think pretty much I felt that at least the magazines and the journals that I read were very sympathetic towards the women. My only concern is that the press sometimes does not want to go dig deeper into the connections. I don't want to keep it short, I don't want to go on and on, but dig deeper into the connections. You know, it's very easy to blame the cops, or it's very easy to blame, you know, but who's, why is it so much protection is being given to them from the highest authorities? Why did Sonia Gandhi not go and visit the 16-year-old Suman that Kritika talked about, and she went and visited a Dalit girl who was raped by a Dalit man because that wasn't controversial. But she did not go and visit the Suman, the 16-year-old child, who was raped by men who had powerful connections with Congress. So, you know, I'm not sure if the press is taking up some of those really important questions.
My question is related to what is clear to me is violence against women that is taking place, whether it's at the Dalit or professional women as she mentioned. Do you think that the capitalist penetration in India has changed cultural values? And patriarchy feels is feel threatened by the change. Do you think that's the reason for the violence against women? I'm talking about women in general, because what it seems to me, what I gather, is that it's violence against, extreme violence. Let me give an example. It's not only in India. So in Latin America, we are having pretty much the same similar situation. For instance, statistics show, I don't have the data with me, that as governments are protecting the right of women to be women and to be equal to men, violence against women has increased, not only in terms of rape, but also in terms of crime. Domestic violence is very high. So my question is related to that.
I can substantiate your question, but in my opinion, yeah, the incidence of capitalism and development as is viewed through the lens of the West does also affect how societal patterns are left in the society, in the sense that I guess one of the most quintessential things which results in development is ownership of resources. So once you keep on developing, take land for instance, and ownership of land, who has ownership of land? The male member of the society or the eldest male of the family. With development, when he sees that piece of land bringing him prosperity, he becomes more insecure about it. Once he becomes more insecure about it, that insecurity results in maybe more violence to women, maybe not giving them a share in the property, maybe being even more dogmatic about the fact that the property remained within his caste, within maybe his familial lineage. But on the flip side I wouldn't exactly call it capitalism, but capitalism also brings with it the fact that, you know, the world has opened out to more cultures. And since it has opened out to more cultures, maybe in some way it's also knocking, you know, some part of your mind which says that, you know, if women have it so good in other countries, why not over here? So you suddenly don't feel that bad about voicing out your concerns.
Well, one of the things about some of the atrocities committed against Dalits in my state, Lakshmipeta, is that the sarpanch, which was the local official of the village, was actually a Dalit woman who could not even stand in front of the dominant community, although she was the elected official. So, but one of the common threads I have seen in all these atrocities is that there has been a lot of assertion, whether it is women asserting their independence, like in Kerlanji in Maharashtra, where the woman was asserting her independence, was making a children's study so they could go forward. So that also creates a certain resentment in certain dominant structures in the society. So the crimes have become more and more horrific each time. And we saw that in Gujarat when they killed Muslims. Women were particularly affected, you know, the worst kind of sexual violence. You can imagine pregnant women. So I think the form of violence has changed, I think, but also to do with being assertive. And I'm not sure if it's, your question is very good, whether capitalism in itself also has brought certain things with it. But certainly in the villages, it's also to do with land and assertion.
I just wanted to go, I really didn't get the feel of what is patriarchy and, you know, how it underlines the globe. This is, we're not talking about patriarchy as in Haryana or in India. Patriarchy, really, if you start to look at what is it? You know, what are the tentacles of that patriarchy? Because if we don't look at that, then how do we even start to get rid of it, or how do we start to deal with it? So what do you think? What is patriarchy? And where does it come from? What is it?
The anthropological definition of patriarchy is the rule of the eldest male of the family. But I think patriarchy is a very convenient term, in the sense that it's sort of all-encompassing, it's an all-encompassing word to anything that is wrong and that is happening to a woman, and you just term it as patriarchal without really being aware of what the word, you know, really means or brings under. But I think in the Indian context, at least, patriarchy means male domination or male aggression, or maybe male insecurity to maintain their domination and thereby ownership over financial resources. I just want to add to that, and also again, because that is a very valid point in coming back to what your question is about, also about the linkages between capitalism. Currently in India, as I was just, I was packing my bags to come here, in our Indian television, which has all sorts of products right now, thanks to an open market, in the 70s and 80s, we just had one fairness cream. And if we think that, if we are to assume that people are getting wiser as time goes by, you'd like to think that we would not have fairness cream today. But as where I speak and stand, we have many more brands of fairness cream for women and for men. So what is that doing to the ideas of what you are? We don't just have only fairness cream for women, we have vagina whitening creams and we have vagina tightening creams. That therein comes in the whole idea of patriarchy. Then again, therein comes the whole idea of, you know, because, well, the West already has a vagina tightening cream. Now it's in India. Now you don't have to come all the way here to get, you know, a surgery or to get it, but you can have it all the way in India. So again, I mean, even to say that the term patriarchy cannot always be challenged, or you know, it's I think it's problematic, is because then we have to then question, then where does the whole feminist movement leave out to? Because then you have the other extreme going on about it. But again, if we have to come back to it, I think what we are trying to talk about is that whenever there is any kind of manifestation of class, which is across the world, and it's increasing more so in a globalized capitalist world, wherever you have the influence of caste, like in